the setting of the sun. I will stand on every promise of your words of power, strong to save, that will never pass away. I will stand on every promise of your word. For your covenant is sure, and on this I am secure. I can stand on every promise of your word. When I stumble and I sin, condemnation pressing in, I will stand on every promise of your word. You are faithful to forgive, that in freedom I might live. So I stand on every promise of your word. Guilt to innocence restored, you remember sins no more. So I'll stand on every promise of your word. Choice, I will listen for your voice, and I'll stand on every promise of your word. Through this dark and troubled land, you will guide me with your hand, as I stand on every promise of your word. And you've promised to complete every work begun in me. So I'll stand on every promise of your word. I'll stand on your promises. Yes, I'll stand. Love that casts out every fear, as I stand on every promise of your word. Not forsaken, not alone, for the Comforter has come, and I stand on every promise of. Sufficient grace for me, grace for all who will believe. We will stand on every promise of your word. Grace sufficient grace for me, grace for all who will believe. We will stand on every promise of your word. Grace sufficient grace for me, grace for all who will believe. We will stand on every promise of your word. Grace sufficient grace for me, grace for all who will believe. We will stand on every promise of your word.
Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me. For you are the God of salvation. For you I wait all day long. Good morning, everybody. It is good to be with you today. Good morning to those of us here at Putney Methodist.
Good morning to
those of you at home on Zoom, and good morning to those who are watching later on YouTube. I do hope that this better weather finds you in good mood today. It's so much nicer to be in the church today. I almost took my jacket off. It's that warm, so how nice. But it's great to be with you all. I do hope that you're enjoying some of the new music we're playing. I think one of the great blessings of this time has been that we're learning some new hymns, so I hope you're enjoying those. And do let me know if you found any new favourites. We're going to continue in worship this day, though, with an old favourite, one that still speaks to us, from our own PMC singers. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand hath.
Oh, my God, where are you?
very much to Leslie for doing a huge amount of work to overlay all those tracks and prepare that hymn, and to all the singers. On this first Sunday in Advent, let us come before God in prayer. Let us pray. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand hath made, I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Loving God, that hymn reminds us of why we are here today, to offer you praise and worship, for you alone are worthy of such praise and worship. You alone created the heavens and the earth out of nothing. You alone are the sustainer of all that we see. You alone sent your Son to die on the cross, my burden gladly bearing. You alone are our Creator, our Sustainer, and our Redeemer. And we gladly offer you our worship this day. On this first Sunday in Lent, as we once again begin our Lenten journey, for some for the first time, but for many of us, for countless times, we once again turn our hearts and minds to you and to your cross. We come before you in honesty, but with faith and hope. We offer to you all that we are ashamed of in our lives. And we acknowledge the reality of temptation at this time. We ask for your forgiveness, Lord, for all that we have done wrong and for the good we have not done. We pray, O Lord, for forgiveness for ourselves and for our world. In this holy season of Lent, help us, we pray, O Lord, to become the people you want us to be. And as we journey towards Calvary and the cross, help us to know that we are forgiven, loved, and free through your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Open our hearts and minds, we pray, this day, as we come to you in worship, and let all be said and done to your glory and praise, O Lord. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Well, it seems incredible that here we are at the beginning of Lent once more. It's hard at this time not to keep thinking back to this time last year when we were sort of aware of coronavirus, but it didn't perhaps seem so close. And we were just beginning our Lenten theme, looking at Jesus Christ Superstar. We were looking forward to a production by Plos at Easter time. How long ago that all seems now. Well, we are starting our journey once more. And this year our theme is a simple theme. Tell me the stories of Jesus. Some of you may remember the old hymn. I can just about remember it from my Sunday school days with a rather tacky yellow Sunday school hymn book, I seem to recall. Each week during this Lenten season, our preachers are going to look at one story of Jesus. Jesus doing something, Jesus interacting with somebody, Jesus being with someone. And we're going to reflect on two simple questions. What does the story tell us about Jesus? What does the story tell us about us? What does it tell us about me and you? And we're going to begin this day with a very appropriate story, the story that we traditionally hear at this time of year. the story of Jesus going out into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And I'm pleased to say that Peck is going to read to us now the story from Matthew's Gospel.
Jesus said to him, "Again, it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan. For it is written, worship the Lord your God, and serve on him." Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. Thanks be to God for his holy word and scripture. Amen.
We hear now, thank you, Epec, we hear now the traditional hymn for the start of this season. Hymn number 236, 40 days and 40 nights you were fasting in the wild.
Forty days and forty nights.
thank you once again to the POC singers. If you listen very closely in the fifth verse, you can hear Nigel and I disagreeing about how the words should fit to the music. One of the challenges of recording individually. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. What then does this story tell us about Jesus? Well, the first thing is that Jesus thought that time alone was important. Now, a few weeks ago, we had a lovely service with Bill and the members of the community at the University of Roehampton, and we stressed there the importance of Christian community and of living together. And Jesus was a great exponent of that. He lived most of his ministry, and indeed his life really, in community with others. He travelled during his 3 years in his active ministry with at least 12 other disciples, probably many more. And they lived together, they ate together, they shared accommodation, and they had a common purse, we know. But at the same time, we know that Jesus valued time apart. Repeatedly in the Gospels, Jesus disappears to spend time alone to pray, often to the annoyance of his disciples and the people who had come to try and listen to him or wanted him to do things. But Jesus took time apart to sit and listen to God in silence. Whoever Jesus was, he needed that time alone so that he could sit and listen to God. And he could do the incredible things he could do. It was not an optional extra, it was an essential part of his ministry. Perhaps more importantly, this particular time alone was crucial to Jesus' identity and his destiny. It shaped who he was. The Gospels are very clear that the baptism of Jesus, which takes place in all of the Gospels immediately before this time in the wilderness, marked a very clear dividing line in Jesus' life between his private and his public life. Before this time, we know very little about Jesus. At present, in Sunday evenings, and please do join us if you'd like to, we've been studying Mark's Gospel, Mark, the earliest Gospel to be written, and Mark is very clear that what happens before the baptism really is not that important. He goes straight in 9 verses, up to the baptism. Now, from the other Gospels, we glean information about Jesus' birth. From Luke, we know a little bit about his teenage years, and we get hints. We know he came from Nazareth. He was a small town boy. He was the son of Mary and Joseph. Probably he trained as a carpenter. And at the age of 30, which is what we believe he was probably on the cusp of adult life, we might say, in that part of the world at that time. At that time he would probably be about to take a wife and start a family. After this time, though, his life was completely different. And we have huge amounts of detail about his everyday actions and what he was doing. And of course, in that final week of his life in Holy Week, we have almost an hour-by-hour record of what he did. The book I'm reading at the minute by Richard Borkham highlights a verse that I hadn't noticed before in the book of Acts. And it comes at the beginning of the book when the 11 apostles meet together to choose a replacement for Judas, who has committed suicide by this time. And Peter, speaking, establishes one key criterion for choosing the new apostle. He says, "So one of the men," and of course I'm afraid it is still a sexist world, "so one of the men who have accompanied us throughout the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken up from us, one of these must become a witness with us." So the key criterion was that it was somebody who had been with Jesus from the beginning of his ministry, from his baptism and to his end. That was all that was important. Peter didn't say, oh, well, it's important that you knew what Jesus was like when he was a young man or when he was a teenager or you were a friend of his before. That was what counted. So this time in the wilderness was Jesus' last time before he was famous, so to speak. It was the last time he could be a private individual. I'm going to make a very inappropriate analogy that struck me this week. It just reminded me very slightly, some of you may recall Friends. I'm sure some of you know Friends, the American sitcom series that ran for many, many, many years and made its stars very rich and very famous across the world. And all of the Friends actors record a particular incident where, just after they recorded the first season, their director, a chap called Jimmy Burrows, worked out that this comedy show was going to be an enormous hit. And he took the cast, he took the six actors, off to Las Vegas for a weekend, and he paid for an all-expenses-paid trip. And Jennifer Aniston recalls that the director sat them down and said, I want to take you out to dinner. And he gave them each a couple of $100s, and he said, I'm going to that casino and go and gamble, because this is the last time you'll be able to do anything anonymously. And we had no clue what he was talking about, but sure enough, he was right. But a few weeks later, the series began to be broadcast, and they became international megastars, and they couldn't go anywhere without being photographed or noticed. Now, I'm not saying Jesus is like Jennifer Aniston or David Schwimmer, but there is something about that markation. This was the last time Jesus could go anywhere and not be recognized. And as the Gospels go on, Jesus becomes more and more famous. People clamor more and more for his attention. Heal me, Lord. If we'd had that production of Jesus Christ Superstar, there's that wonderful moment in it when they go, heal me, Lord, touch me, Lord, save me, Lord. And Jesus just wants to be by himself. And of course, as he goes on, Jesus can go nowhere without being both loved and hated. So this time in the wilderness is his last chance to be just a man. It's more than a simple marker in time, though. We all understand the concept of temptation and what went on in the wilderness there. And it's important that we heard in the passage that the translation correctly says, the tempter says this, the tempter says that. We shouldn't get too worked up, perhaps, about devils with pointy hair, pointy horns and tails and all the rest of it. But I believe strongly that this time in the wilderness was when Jesus ultimately faced up to the question of who he was, of his identity. Now, there's a huge amount of Christian theology about this, about Jesus being both fully man and fully God. We do not understand, and we never will probably in this life, how Jesus understood his own destiny and when he came to fully recognize who he was and how he reconciled those two aspects of his divine character. But arguably, this time in the wilderness, these 40 days, was where the tire hit the road, we might say, and seemingly, perhaps Jesus faced choice. I can't help but think of the famous poem that many of us might have studied in English literature, The Road Not Taken by Robert Frost. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both. Jesus often spoke of the way, and Christianity was first known as the way, and we talk about following Jesus on the way of the Lord. And we might like to think about two ways out of that desert for Jesus. Even after his baptism, he was still seemingly a private individual. One way led back to Nazareth, to home, to security, to safety, to a job, to a wife, to a family, to a long life, and grandchildren, and all that comes with that. The other way leads to Jerusalem, to Gethsemane, and to the cross. Jesus in that time had to choose who he was. And he defied the tempter, and he chose the harder path. What does the story tell us about us? Well, in this time of pandemic, the analogy of a wilderness has probably, like all good analogies, been overused. There are many obvious parallels, though, and when we started doing Bible studies last year, it was to the wilderness that we went almost immediately. This has been a time of stripping away, of isolation, when many familiar comforts have been taken away. Like Jesus in the desert too, this time has forced many people to face the realities and temptations of their own life. Perhaps feelings, facts that they have long denied. And it has challenged them, like Jesus, to face that central question of their identity. Who am I? The full effects of this time will be very long lasting, and they will provide plenty of material for study for years to come. But we can already see some of its impact. In a negative way, I have seen how, like being in a wilderness, this time has denied people many of the distractions that often fill people's lives. Going out, socializing, drinking, holidays, perhaps even their jobs. For many people, such activities are integral to their identity. And when that is taken away, who are they? Who are we? I know many ministers have faced that challenge when key parts of their ministry have been removed or destroyed. And I know of people who do not like the person they find themselves to be, who cannot cope without the things that have filled their hours before. For better or worse, this time of isolation has forced us to spend more time with our loved ones. One man I know, and he's going to remain absolutely anonymous, said to me, "I love my wife, but when I married her, I didn't think I'd spend quite so much time with her." Now, there's a very serious point to that. And sadly, I think we will see, as a result of this time, the divorce rate and family breakdowns on the increase. Because it has forced many people to recognize aspects of their relationships that are not healthy and not good. For many, therefore, this wilderness time has revealed that they are not really happy with the person they have become, the job they have, the relationships they are in, and they are now struggling to find a way out of the desert. In a much more positive sense, though, I know of many people who have found this time, and still are finding it, a period of growth and development, the polar opposite of everything I have just said, who have realized that their identity had become lost in their business, and that they didn't need to be defined by their job. They didn't need to work endless hours. They didn't need to commute. Perhaps they didn't need so many things or activities in their lives. That they enjoy spending time quietly with their family or their children. Or that while it might be nice to see a few people now and then, they are actually quite content with their own company. Perhaps they have discovered new pastimes, new hobbies. Perhaps they're going to seek out a new job, a new place to live. For them, this time has been a period of growth and self-awareness. Personally, I have found this a very challenging time for a large number of reasons. But I have rediscovered my love of learning, and on Thursday mornings, please don't bother to ring me because I won't pick up the phone, because I have a New Testament Greek class that I'm doing via Zoom with people across the country, and that's been a great joy. But also, by chance, I've read a large number of books and seen some documentaries that have formed quite a theme about what makes us happy and how we relate to our possessions. And I read a book called Digital Minimalism, which I would commend to you. And it's really aimed at technology addicts, and you can decide whether you're one of those or not. And the author commends a total digital detox, where you take everything off your phone, where you ideally go back to having an old brick of a phone, so you can't even look at it even if you wanted to. And you do that for a period, for, he says, 30 days, but we might like to think of 40 days as being a better time. And then after that, you gradually put things back onto your phone, some of the apps, some of the applications, some of the programs, and you decide what goes back on. And if you put it on and you decide it's not healthy for you, you just take it off. And he talks about people's experience of doing this and people discovering how much more time they have and how some things on their phones or some things in their life, some emails or whatever, are really not good for them, they're not healthy. As we emerge from this desert, as individuals, as a nation, as a church, it might be helpful for us to do something similar. Not to take everything back on immediately and say, oh, hurrah, we're back, oh, let's take everything, let's do everything we can do. But perhaps take things one by one and reflect on what we need to take back on and what can be left in the wilderness. As we ponder this story of Jesus in the wilderness, therefore, like Jeff last week, and his point that he made about how this shouldn't be a pause, but this should be a time for growth and change, I would encourage you to reflect upon your own journey of self-discovery in this time, for good and for ill. What have we learned about ourselves, both that we like and that we don't like? What is God trying to say to us through this time? What are the temptations we have faced and the temptations we will face as we emerge from this pandemic? I pray that even amidst the madness of homeschooling, endless Zooms, and all the rest of it, you too may find a space and a time to reflect on some of those questions. And I pray that, like Christ, and by his grace and mercy, we may all emerge from this desert experience, ready to face the challenge of being the person God wants us to be. The God who made us, shaped us, and loves us every step of our journey through life. I'd like to close my reflection today with a poem by Ruth Burgess, which she wrote for this Sunday in Lent. The desert waits, ready for those who come, who are obedient to the Spirit's leading, or who are driven because they will come no other way. The desert always waits, ready to let us know who we are, the place of self-discovery. And whilst we fear, and rightly, the loneliness and emptiness and harshness, we forget the angels, whom we cannot see for our blindness, but who come when God decides that we need their help, when we are ready for what they can give us. Amen. we're going to hear another hymn that is quite new to us, certainly new to me, from our hymn book number 241, When We Were in the Darkest Night and Wondered If Our Eyes Would Ever See the Light. Sadly, it is an aspect of our life here that people come and people go. We have been very blessed recently by having Hassan with us, who's here today. And Hassan's been studying at the university, and it's been great to get to know Hassan. But we're very pleased, we rejoice that Hassan's got a new job to go to in the UK, and we are really pleased for you, Hassan, and we know that's an answer to prayer. Thank you for being with us, and we pray every blessing upon you, and we pray that this new job will be a great blessing for you. We know that you will be a blessing to our country, so thank you very much, Hassan. So goodbye to Hassan, but hello to somebody we know very well, and ask Tila to come up. Many of you will know Tina. You can remove your mask if you're fine. Many of you will know Tina already, and Tina's been worshiping here and leading worship here and doing all sorts of things here for years and years. But for complicated reasons, her membership was elsewhere in London. But Tina would very much like to have her membership here formally, so that she can. So that we're all one happy family again. And we are delighted to transfer your membership back here, Tina, and we're delighted that you are here with us today. So all I say to you, Tina, at this moment, because we cannot offer the right hand of fellowship unless it were massively disinfected, is we say to you, Tina, we receive and welcome you as a member of the Methodist Church and of the church in this place. May the Lord bless you with his grace and fill you with his peace. And now Tina is. Oh, we're allowed to clap, aren't we? Clapping is still allowed. And Tina is now going to lead us in our prayers. Thank you, Tina.
When I say the words, Lord, in your mercy, you are invited to respond. And say, hear our prayer. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of the wilderness, we give thanks this day for the blessings we have received, even in these difficult days. We thank you for the dedication and hard work of all our key workers, especially those in the NHS and our care sector. We thank you for the bravery and commitment of those who keep on working, risking their lives and their health for the sake of others. Grant them your protection, Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In this season of Lent, we pray all those who are facing their own wildernesses at this challenging time. We pray for the sick and the ill, and for all who love and care for them. We pray for the dying, and for all who mourn and grieve. Grant them healing. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are in despair at this time, for those who face the loss of homes, jobs, and security, for those living in fear of the future, for those who cannot see a way out of the wilderness, grant them peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who exercise authority in your name, for those who must make vital decisions, potentially changing the fate of nations. for our Prime Minister and government as they set out their plans tomorrow. For the leaders of the world, fighting for an equitable distribution of vaccines. Grant them your wisdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Finally, Lord, we pray for our own needs and those of the ones closest to us. In a moment of stillness, we offer our prayers to you now. Grant us all the knowledge of your love and your presence in our lives. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We bring all our prayers together in the one that Christ taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever.
Thank you, Tina. And thank you to everyone who's participated in our service today, those who recorded music, and especially to Lecky and to Ben, who have worked so hard. And having tried to help last week, I've realised just how difficult it is. So if anybody out there would like to try and help a bit and would be willing to come and assist, we'd love to hear from you. But thank you very much to both of you for all your hard work throughout this time. Next week, there's a slight change in the plan. I haven't dared to tell Margaret Logan that we've changed the plan just after she's printed it. So, but just to say, next week, it's not Isabel Taylor, it's me. And we're going to be doing, just to help things along a bit, I'm going to be broadcasting from home, so I'll be on Zoom. But thanks to a volunteer here, we will be able to have sharing the Zoom service here. On Thursday night, our Lent talks, the churches together in Putney and Rampton, Lent talks begin. Do zoom in if you can. It's going to be a very interesting discussion about what is truth. What is truth? Unfortunately, several of us, I wouldn't mind, we've got a circuit meeting on Thursday night, so I've had to send my apologies, but do join in. Got Bible study tonight, got discussion group tomorrow night. And today we've got something very nice. We can wish Alison a very happy birthday. Alison's 21 today. So, sorry, that was Ben's fault for telling me beforehand. So, I'm sure the folks on Zoom are wishing you a happy birthday too, Alison. Whatever the week ahead holds for you, I do hope you manage to stay safe and well. We're going to conclude our service today. As usual, I've tried to sort of bring a different piece of music. Now, the music this week is a Marmite piece. You're either going to love it or hate it. So if you hate it, please don't be afraid. If you're watching at home especially, do just wander off and get a cup of tea and then come back and join us afterwards. It's the Irish Blessing, and it's recorded, people from across Ireland recording a song that you'll recognise. Some of the folks are trying a bit too hard, if you know what I mean. And there is definitely a Father Ted moment in there, or two. But I think it's rather lovely, and especially at this time when we can't travel and see different places, I thought it might be a nice way to conclude our worship. But I hope to see you again very soon. Stay safe and stay well. And we conclude our worship with the blessing. May the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest upon us all this day and evermore.
Be thou my wisdom, be thou my true one. Christ be with you. Christ within you.
Christ be.
Go mani and cheer na hu, agus go goody she hu.
The Lord met the licht o' his face, and the goodness o' his heart to be bricht upon you.
The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
The Lord bless you
and keep you.
The Lord make his
face to shine upon you
and be gracious to you.
The Lord lift up his countenance upon you
and give you peace.
نباركك الرب ويحرسك
Niech cię Pan błogosławi i strzeże.
Faka se lumineze faca lui peste
Fechoneka
Jehova, tirumukam nindamelu yarti Nenaka samad
Kosi fuini alafia.